Well, brothers and sisters, welcome. Thank you for joining us once again for the second webinar in the Kingdoms and Identity series. I'm so delighted to be joined once again tonight with my co-host, Dan Yoon. Dan, say hello to the people.
Great to see you all. Thanks for joining us.
And we're going to be hearing very shortly from Reverend Dr. Zack Eswine as he talks to us about what it means to proclaim Jesus with wisdom. Zack, give him a little shout.
Hey, it's really good to be with everybody. And as I was saying earlier, giving it, very glad to be able to give an opportunity to try together and learn about these difficult but important things.
Absolutely. We really hope, brothers and sisters, that this series will be a blessing to you as you seek to shepherd your people in the way of Jesus and as you seek to disciple them in the way of the cross in the midst of a political atmosphere that really wars against the soul in a lot of ways. So we're eager to be equipped and encouraged together. We thank you for joining us tonight. Thank you to all the teaching elders and ruling elders who would like to think well and think biblically about how we can proclaim Jesus with wisdom. So as we get started tonight, Dan, would you lift up our time together in prayer?
Absolutely, let's pray. Oh, Lord, thank you for this opportunity to gather in this way. God, the picture that comes to mind is all of us as your people, as your children, as your disciples, just huddling at your feet, just inclining our ear towards your voice, desiring to come that much closer, to know your heart, to know your ways, that from you, as we abide in you, as we remain in you, we're able to bear fruit that would certainly be for our benefit and enjoyment, but God, truly for your glory, that you might be lifted up. And so, Lord, we need you in any matter of formation, in any matter of being shaped, with all the different voices and dynamics and things that are pressing upon us. God, we want to yield primarily to you, to your desires and your spirit. And so, God, would this exercise, would this time in and of itself be an expression of our desire to be molded by you? So, Holy Spirit, help us to be humble, help us to have open hearts, shape our minds, that again, we might be better equipped to love you well, but also to serve the people around us as we draw them closer to you in this way and in this season. And so be with Zach as he shares from the heart his experiences, but certainly from your word and from your heart as well. So we thank you for this time. Lead us, we pray, for your glory in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
So Zach, love to hand it over to you, sir. Take it away.
All right. Thank you, Dan. Well, welcome tonight. In our webinar last week, we sought to establish a biblical framework, seeking Jesus as the Bible presents him, trying to find biblical help for so that those that we serve can better discern another Jesus from Jesus as the apostles proclaimed him. And we looked at that together. And tonight, what we'd like to do is to think about how do we communicate in light of this biblical framework in Christ? How do we communicate to those who have real questions, finding themselves confused, disoriented, and we want to be of good shepherding help to them? What do we do? So I'd like to think about that tonight. What do we do on the side of communication? And to begin, we'll take about our first 12, 14 minutes right in there to take a big picture reminder about wisdom and its biblical role in communicating to other people. And then in light of that, we'll take the rest of our time of content looking at real questions that people have and how we might address them directly and indirectly from the scriptures. And then we'll have Q&A together. So let's begin with a big picture reminder about the wisdom shape of pastoral communication as ministry leaders and local lay leaders, and how do we communicate wisely? When I think about wisdom and communication, a bit of my own experience first. My own experience would be something like this. In my theological training, the emphasis has been on, wonderfully, it's been on prophet, priest, and king. And we don't want anything less than that. A profound, rich heritage to perceive Jesus fulfilling those three roles. But the weakness in my, at least in my mentoring and training, has been Jesus as one greater than Solomon, Jesus as the fulfillment of wisdom, Jesus as wisdom itself. And so thinking theologically about Jesus as our prophet, priest, king, and sage, our wise, our wisdom, is something that can help us here in this political moment. Secondly, my homiletical training, that means when I was learning to preach and teach the Bible, the prophet was the primary paradigm for thinking about preaching. It's that way in the history of preaching as well. And we don't want less than that. But it would have been strange to hear the idea that a sermon could be, or a Bible study could be, a wisdom text for wisdom formation. That would have been an odd kind of thing. We had overlooked a passage such as Matthew 23, verse 34. Matthew 23, verse 34. This is where our Lord Jesus is talking about the trials of the times to come. And he names his disciples who will communicate on his behalf. And he calls them prophets and wise men and scribes. And this idea of our Lord Jesus communicating as a wise one and through wise ones, that was new to me. And then apologetics. When I was trained in how to think about the questions that our culture brings at us or has for us, we dipped our straw in the tall glass of Western philosophical waters. You know, if there was the problem of evil, we looked at Epicurus and we thought about the logical syllogism, and we tried to find what we could that was coherent and logically consistent in our answers. We don't want less than that. But it never occurred to me in my training that when Jesus answers the problem of evil, he tells a story. Once upon a time, there was a farmer, and he was a good farmer. And when he went to sleep after having sown his seed, when he and his servants woke up the next day, there were weeds that had infested the entire farm. And the servants said, we thought you were a good farmer. How could this happen? And right there, Jesus is addressing the question of the problem of evil. How can a good God allow bad things to happen? But Jesus's way, in that wisdom way, is a story. And then finally, the stylistically, the way of wisdom, biblically, Proverbs 25:15, a soft answer breaks a bone. And so it's this gentle approach that's palpable in its impact. It isn't weak by any stretch of the imagination. It will break a bone. It's powerful, but its approach is gentle. And so a couple of examples that you'll know right away. When our Lord Jesus turns to his disciples, he doesn't say first, who do you say that I am? The first thing he does is start out here somewhere. Who do people say that I am? And then as they think about those people and what those people say and what they've heard said, Jesus then says, who do you say that I am? If you remember King David, the prophet Nathan didn't knock the door down. Woe to you, David. You know, it was, oh, King, may I tell you a story? And by the end of that story, as David finds himself in it, the bone is about to be broken. Nathan says, you are the man. So what I'm saying here is that I don't think I'm alone. A lot of us have not been exposed to as much to the wisdom side of the scriptures, Lamentations or Ecclesiastes, Proverbs, Job, James, or the Gospels of Jesus, and seeing Jesus not only as our prophet, priest, and king, but also our sage. Now, what difference would that make for a talk like this, trying to think about how to help those we serve in a confusing, polarizing political moment? The first thing is a voice, and the second thing is a mood, and then we'll look at specific questions. I'd like to remind you about a voice. Many of us have one voice in our communication toolbox. It's the prophet's voice. what is true and what to do. But let's remind ourselves of how the prophet, the priest, and the sage communicates the truth of God differently. Same truth, different approach. I'll remind you quickly. Isaiah chapter 5, verses 22 through 24, Isaiah is addressing the sin of drunkenness. Let me just give you a sense of how that sounds. And I'll do it quietly, but he wasn't quiet. Woe to those who are heroes at drinking wine and valiant men in mixing strong drink, who acquit the guilty for a bribe and deprive the innocent of his right! Exclamation point. Right? The translators are trying to capture it for us. Exclamation points. This is intensity, right? And by the time you get to "they have despised the Holy One of Israel," you realize there's no discussion here. Discussion is over. The prophet has spoken. How will we respond? Yeah. Now, in Deuteronomy chapter 14, verses 24 through 26, listen to how the priest talks about alcohol. "And if the way is too long for you so that you are not able to carry the tithe when the Lord your God blesses you, because the place is too far from you, which the Lord your God chooses to set his name there, then you shall turn it into money, bind up the money in your hand, go to the place that the Lord your God chooses, and spend the money for whatever you desire, oxen or sheep or wine or strong drink, whatever your appetite craves, and you shall eat there before the Lord your God and rejoice, you and your household." Well, there's no exclamation points there. There's no woe to use there. This is catechetical. It's just teaching. Here's what you do, and here's what you don't do. Now listen to the biblical sage talk about alcohol. It's in Proverbs chapter 23, verses 29 through 35. Listen to how it begins. "Who has woe? Who has sorrow? Who has strife? Who has complaining? Who has wounds without cause? Who has redness of eyes? Those who tarry long over wine, those who go to try mixed wine, do not look at wine when it is red, when it sparkles in the cup and goes down smoothly. In the end, it bites like a serpent. It stings like an adder. Your eyes will see strange things. Your heart utter perverse things. You will be like one who lies down in the midst of the sea, like one who lies on the top of a mast. They struck me, you will say, but I was not hurt. They beat me, but I did not feel it. When shall I awake? I must have another drink." Now, I'm not trying to be clever. It's just that last verse is in quotes. The wise want the young ones to hear what it sounds like. What did you notice about that? It begins with questions. Instead of "woe to you," it's "who has woe?" And then the sage talks from the inside of the experience, like they know why it's tempting. It sparkles in the cup. It goes down smoothly. And the effect of it on your life, you become unfiltered. You're off balance physically. If someone hits you, you don't even feel it. And then draws the conclusion there. And then after all of that, we just want to do it again. Now, the thing about the way the wise approach it is that they stop right there. And then it goes into another set of proverbs. And what it assumes is two things. We're not going to solve this all at once. Second, we're in a community of conversation, talking about wisdom. Third, that means we're going to keep chewing on this picture of what was given. And in conversation, it will do its work on us. A soft answer breaks a bone. Here's what I'm saying for our talk tonight. As we think about trying to help those in our political moment, some of us wonderfully have the prophetic paradigm in our toolbox. And what we want to do is also remember God speaks like a priest sometimes. God speaks like a sage sometimes. He communicates to us in these various ways in his word. And we want to learn that too. Now, one other thought here about that is that affects our mood. So not only does it move us from one voice to three voices in our toolbox, it moves us from two moods to five moods. I'll just say this quickly, because really what we're after is how do we answer the questions of those we're trying to serve? But two moods, what is true and what to do? That's the indicative, that's the imperative. Many of us have wonderfully been trained in that way. If someone asks a question, here's what we say. Here's what's true, and here's what to do. If we had time, we could walk through all the questions our Lord Jesus is asked, and we would remind ourselves that out of 180 plus questions, our Lord Jesus only answers three. And he doesn't choose what is true and what to do when he answers. There's an interrogative mood, questions. How do you read it? What do you make of it? Who, what, where, why, when, how? There's the subjunctive mood. It's what we can imagine. Lord, I want to follow you wherever you go. And the Lord Jesus says, here's what is true about that, and here's what you should do. Nope. The Lord Jesus says, foxes have dens, birds have nests, the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. And now he's quiet. And now it's up to you to respond. And what he's just done is, as a sage, he's put a proverb in front of you. And now you're to imagine yourself as the characters in that fable. I'm like a fox. I'm a bird. A den. Was that about security? What's he say? I don't have a place to stay. And you're working it out there. And you're imagining yourself in those different positions, choosing possibilities, and then having to choose. And then the final mood there for now is the optative mood. That's the mood of desire and longing. Oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, how I would have gathered you like a mother hen with her chicks. It's this expression of longing and desire. Here's all I want to say tonight. I'm drawing upon some assumptions here. That when we go to shepherd the people we serve, the Lord Jesus didn't speak to the woman at the well or to Zacchaeus the tax collector the way he spoke to the Pharisees in Matthew 23. And the Lord Jesus didn't speak all of those woe to yous until Matthew 23. So for almost two and three quarter years, almost 3 years, woe to you was not our Lord's default mode of speech. And so in our toolbox, following our Lord Jesus, we can ask questions, we can express longing, we can imagine and set in front of someone possible roads and help them think through things. And all of this is a way that God himself, through Jesus Christ, relates to his people. It's prophet, priest, king, and sage, and with this expanded full range of mood in the way he approaches us. All of that can help us. And this is our final thought before we then move toward why. What are some questions that we need to answer? The final thought here is this. This might help us, this background might help us when we think about how the Lord Jesus speaks. When he begins, it's, you have heard it said, but I say to you. Well, there's an it. You have heard it said. And so through the Sermon on the Mount, there are very different subjects that our Lord Jesus walks through, and he talks about each of those subjects. For us, the it would be politics. You have heard said about politics, right? The next statement, I am prone to skip, and maybe some of us are too. But the next statement reminds us that our Lord Jesus is a listening talker, which the wise always are. Quick to listen, slow to speak, slow to vent. The next thing our Lord says is, you've heard said. You've heard said. And without mocking anyone or putting on a caricature of a voice, he quotes the very things that people have heard said. He doesn't misquote what people have heard said. He doesn't add to the quote. He doesn't take away from the quote. He doesn't slant the quote. He just quotes what people have heard said. And this is priestly, sagacious language. It's really calm teaching. And so once we say politics and Jesus, the next thing we want to do is put ourselves in the shoes of those we're trying to help. What have they heard said about this? And then there's the but there will be things to commend about what people have heard said, but there are going to be things that are incomplete, maybe even at odds with Jesus himself. And then that final statement, I say to you, there's the Jesus-centered communication. Our Lord Jesus audaciously putting himself as the center of interpreting what you hear said in the world. And now we take what people have heard said, we see the potential problems of what they've heard said, and then we take it and set it at the feet of Jesus, and we have our Lord Jesus interpret for us the way we're meant to understand it. And this is our Lord's approach for the bulk of his public ministry, of course, until he's facing the scoffers scheming to kill him. And then he takes up fully that prophetic mantle and begins to say, woe to you. So there is a whole semester's worth of reminder in a few minutes of a wisdom shape of communication and how it gives us three or four voices rather than one, five moods rather than two, and an approach of what people have heard said, what might be wrong with it, or a problem with it, and how our Lord Jesus would address it. Okay? Now, that gives you some clues about where I'm coming from. As we think now and turn our attention to what have people heard said. And what I'd like to do is look at a handful of questions that people have and things that they think about and ways that we could approach helping them in our various roles together. So I'm going to pause and say a prayer, and that'll signal that we're shifting to our next section. Lord, here we are. We ask that you would open our hearts, that we could hear you. We thank you for hearing all the things we've heard said. Thank you that you're not surprised. Thank you for listening and knowing and putting yourself in our shoes, helping us see what's incomplete about it all, and then reorienting us to you, the completer of our soul, the savior of everything true and good and noble. We thank you, O Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, let's first of all talk about how we might address our political climate indirectly if we were teaching from the Bible. We're just walking through the scriptures, and where it might seem appropriate, we want to offer an implication or an application to our political moment. And then after we do that, let's look at direct questions and how we would do that. So to begin, with an indirect example, I've turned to James chapter 3. If you're able to turn there, I invite you to. James chapter 3, verse 13. Let's imagine you're teaching through the book of James at your Bible study or home group or in a sermon, and you come to verse 13. It says, who is wise and understanding among you? By his good conduct, let him show his works in the meekness of wisdom. And now, so imagine you're walking through that verse and you're coming to that last phrase now, the meekness of wisdom. And you remind those listening that this word is used to describe our Lord Jesus in two different places in the book of Matthew, for example. It's one, Palm Sunday, when the Lord Jesus as a king rode on a lowly colt. The word there is meek, the same Greek word. Or in Matthew chapter 11, where the Lord Jesus says, come to me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest, for my burden is light. And in the Greek it would be, and I am meek. And so what does this word meek mean? It's hard to translate, as you know, but it has to do with power that's restrained. Restraining strength for the sake of gently serving another. We might think of it this way: when You have two children who are playing, and one of the children is older than the other. You say to the older one, if they're starting to get a little rough, you say to the older one, now be gentle now, be gentle. What are you saying to them? You're not saying they're weaklings. You're saying actually they're stronger. And because they're stronger, they need to hold that little bird gently. They're restraining their strength for the service of another. Now, this idea that these Christians who were scattered about in the Roman world, and James is writing to them, and some of them are refugees, and he's writing to them. This idea, James says, is that they are meant to be meek. This is the wisdom of Jesus for them. Now, the Roman world would have mocked this and laughed at it. To restrain your strength for the sake of gentleness toward another, maybe a freeborn Roman, but... And then the Jewish world that Jesus was part of, though the seeds of this teaching are in the scriptures of the Old Testament, as we saw last week, Pharisees, Sadducees, Zealots, Herodians, they were concerned with a different kind of strength and a different kind of power. Jesus isn't weak. The one through whom stallions were created chose a donkey. So let's imagine that they are not the only ones disoriented by Jesus's way with meekness. I'm thinking, right? I'm thinking we're struggling with that too. And right here, if you're communicating from this passage, you're going to make a turn. Normally, you would make a turn of application into our life. So we do that. Can you imagine saying that for your child to get ahead in life, you need to have meek schools with meek teachers? Could you imagine saying that for our churches to make a gospel difference in the world, we need meek ministries with meek leaders? And now we're going to go one more step. And you know what it is now, don't you? Could you imagine for our country to make the difference it's meant to in the world, what we most need is a meek America and a meek president? Well, there we are, walking through a passage of scripture, and on the basis of what it's saying, in their world, in their Roman world, that would have been misunderstood, not understood. In their Jewish world, that would not have been misunderstood. We have common ground with that. It's hard for us to imagine Christians choosing meekness in that way. The earliest Christians described Jesus in 2 Corinthians 10:1 as meek and gentle. And the Lord Jesus stood up boldly in the presence of all the Sadducees, Pharisees, Herodians, Zealots, the Roman world, and said, "Blessed are the meek." It's a different kind of power. Now we could ask one more thing about this. Some people will say, well, that won't work anymore. Maybe that worked in the past for Christians to have the meekness of wisdom. Maybe it worked in an earlier generation, but now we have to fight fire with fire. Have you ever heard something like that? What have people heard said is what we're doing right now. You heard something said like that? Well, here's how I invite you to think of it. I'm no historian, but I think if we say it doesn't work, history would tell us otherwise. Right now, we're not talking about Rome except in the past tense. And who we are talking about is a little band of minority Christians in the first century as followers of Jesus, and how with the wisdom of Jesus, they were encouraging each other to hold on to wisdom from above and to resist wisdom from below. And it begins with meekness, and they turn the world upside down. But biblically, too, when it talks about this meekness of wisdom and wisdom from above, who are they describing? Isn't wisdom from above Jesus? We probably really don't mean it, do we? when we say wisdom from above won't work? We probably don't mean it to say Jesus doesn't work. Jesus and his way doesn't work. We, as soon as we say it on our lips, something feels off, you know. And so I'll stop there. But if you were walking through a passage of scripture, I'm just trying to give an example of how it might be pertinent through the use of questions, inviting someone to think from the text itself, not every week, not every, but when it seems pertinent, you can go there. And in that way, try to help those we serve connect again with the earliest Christians to find themselves again in their story. And their story is our story, and to begin to look at the world again from that light. Now let's think about addressing questions just directly. We're not going through a passage of scripture. It's just someone has asked us questions, and we're going to try to answer them. Well, let's start with easier ones. And then move gradually more difficult. So, and then we'll have Q&A, plenty of time to talk about it. So, all right. First, have you ever heard someone say, we don't want to be on the wrong side of history? Maybe someone you're serving is really concerned about that. Some folks feel energized by that, right? We don't want to be on the wrong side of history. And what they mean by that is they want to do something morally good, and they want to stand for what's good and right. And we're thankful people want to stand for what's good and right and all of that. We just want to have a question, how do we know what's good and right? But others that we serve feel very anxious, especially if they're younger, but not just younger generation. The idea that they would be on the wrong side of history causes them great anxiety. What if I get it wrong? What if I make a mistake? What if at the end of all my effort, I'm left out, I'm separated, I'm placed on the wrong side of history, I'm forever unable to get to the other side where all the righteous are? You know, here's something that we can say. May I encourage you with a thought? For those of you who follow Jesus, we share in this hunger and thirst for righteousness. We too want to choose what is good and right and just. But may I remind you of some good news? According to Jesus, history won't judge us. God will. According to Jesus, none of us at the end of all things will stand before history. History doesn't have that kind of power. After all, isn't history in this sense just us talking to ourselves about ourselves? Judging ourselves? According to Jesus, it won't be history that measures us and separates us into the righteous on this side and the unrighteous on that side. Jesus will do that. He will do the separating, and all of us at the end of all things will end up on this or that side of Jesus, not this or that side of history. The important question is, in our longing to do what's right, is what relation to Jesus do we have? On what side of him are we being found? History isn't a person, but Jesus is. Unlike history, the God who knows all things is just and merciful, full of grace and truth. He knows what we don't, our actions, our motives, our circumstances, challenges, regrets, failures. Your great hope won't be measured by history. Your great hope will be measured by the work of Jesus Christ. And this, in the end, is good, good news. Because if we got something wrong, all isn't lost. And if we got something right, we're humbled to learn where the grace to get something right came from. And before the Lord Jesus, we will be. That's one thought, to try to help those we serve with that kind of question. This next one is a tough one, and as I try to share it, you might disagree with me, and You might disagree because I'm just trying to find language, and I don't have good language yet to resonate with what's true and resonate with you. And we can learn together in our Q&A or follow up. We can just keep finding how would we biblically say this? Or it might sound initially off-putting just because we haven't heard many people talking like this. And so let's hang in there together and let's look at God's word together. And here comes the question, are you ready? Because people hear this said, and the people that we serve and care about need our help. Here it is. What do people hear said? How can a person call himself a Christian and vote Democrat? Or the other way around, how can a person call himself a Christian and vote Republican? Yeah, have you heard that? So here's a way to help. I'd like to invite you into it. Let's turn to Proverbs chapter 6, verses 16 through 19. And then in a moment, we're going to look at Matthew 15, 18 through 20. The first one, Proverbs 6, verses 16 through 19, is where the wise tell us what the abominations are. What does God consider an abomination? Maybe you saw, I don't know, Rudolph or something at the holiday time, the abominable snowman, the thing that is terrible. But in this case, it means the thing that is profoundly sinful before God. And then the Matthew passage is our Lord Jesus telling us what the sins of our hearts are. And they're very similar, as you might expect. Here's Proverbs 6, verses 16 through 19. There are six things that the Lord hates, seven that are an abomination to him: haughty eyes, a lying tongue, hands that shed innocent blood, a heart that devises wicked plans, feet that make haste to run to evil, a false witness who breathes out lies, one who sows discord among brothers. We're asking the question, how could someone be a Christian and vote Republican or Democrat? So now let's look at our Lord Jesus saying something very similar in Matthew 15, where he's talking about what comes out of the heart as what defiles a person. He says, out of the heart come evil thoughts, murder, adultery, sexual immorality, theft, false witness, slander. He's really reflecting the second half of the Ten Commandments, isn't he, here? These are what defile a person. Here's why a Christian might vote one side or another. And it begins with this. We're already put into a difficult position. Things have been reduced. The parties have reduced things in a way the Bible hasn't. So first of all, many in either side of the political aisle will not consider haughty eyes, that is, pridefully looking down on another person, will not consider that, or a lying tongue, or a false witness, or sowing discord among people. Most do not consider those things on par with murder, wickedness, or evil. And so many on all sides of the aisle will view lying and then sowing dissension in the other party as part of what politics requires. I don't mean that everyone wants that. I simply mean that some do, and it becomes a part of the way of things. Misspeaking, mischaracterizing another person. Think of it when it's election time and all the ads come on television and how they describe each character, each person, and how you have to go find two or three different fact checkers and combine and try to see where the truths are and where they're not. This is this confusion on the part of those we serve begins here. But second, let's take an example of how the two parties at their best reduce the biblical story and call upon Christians to do the same. See what you make of it. We're adults here. You can differ with me. Take a look at it and see what you think. Let's just choose verse 17 for our example tonight. Verse 17, Proverbs 6. One of the abominations to the Lord is hands that shed innocent blood. The Lord Jesus, in his version in Matthew 15, just says the word murder. Murder defiles a person. Now, here's what I notice when I speak in my context. If I say, we must recognize justice for the unborn child, that an unborn child is innocent, and the shedding of that unborn child's blood, we should seek justice, care, righteousness for that. If I say that, those who lean left in their politics will suspect that I'm a Republican. If I say in that same sermon, we must recognize justice for adults, any innocent adult whose blood has been shed, this is an abomination to God. Those listening who lean to the right often suspect I'm a Democrat. But a follower of Jesus, committed to the plain teaching of Scripture, knows this. When verse 17, when the wise say, the hands that shed innocent blood are an abomination to God, it does not parse out what age of person. It simply says, the innocent whose blood is shed. Or the way our Lord Jesus says, murder. Someone murdered. No matter who they are, this was not what God created in Eden. This is not where we'll be in the new kingdom. These are the things Jesus died to save us from and to rescue us from. And so how could a Christian vote Democrat? How could a Christian vote Republican? Because every follower of Jesus, it seems to me, is being put into a reduced choice. See what you make of it. Each party seems to have some, highlight some of the biblical teaching, the teaching of Jesus. And each party is known for some of those things and not for some of those other things. So sometimes a Christian is put into a terrible position of conscience because they know if they vote for this party, they know they'll be able to cast their vote for these particular teachings of Jesus and the biblical ethic. But they also know that by casting their vote, they're leaving some of the biblical teachings of Jesus less tended because this party tends some of those others less. Do you see? And so on both sides, it can go this way. Why would a Christian, could a Christian vote this way? Because they're in an impossible situation and they're trying to do the best they can. That's one thought. And to help someone see why this is confusing or difficult is to take us back where we were last week to these lenses, to look at these things through the biblical lens and realize we've had political lenses drop down over there. And so when we read the shedding of innocent blood, one party wants us to see one part of that, and another party wants to see another part of that, but the biblical story just wants us to see it all of that together. And that's why we need help, and that's why it's not easy for a follower of Jesus. There are other reasons. Sometimes Christians just vote. They're going to vote partisan in some kind of way, and that's a whole different subject. But I'm trying to assume that people at their best are trying to sort out a reduction of the biblical story, and they're not quite sure what to do with it. So what do we do? That would be another question. What do you do then? You know that there's a difference between patriotism and nationalism, as we talked about last week. You know that Jesus is a king. We're citizens of that kingdom, and that kingdom is our hope, not the kingdoms of this world. We know that, but we do have the privilege of voting. So now what? What do we do? And here's one way I've been trying to say that to those I serve, and perhaps you'll have a better way to say it. I've just been saying this. Once we prayerfully before the Lord in our conscience choose where we vote, once we vote, we have to live in the other direction. So if I'm voting for a local candidate who upholds the care of the unborn, but has a weaker track record with the poor, care for the poor, I choose which side, where I'm voting. And let's imagine in this case, I chose on the side of the unborn. I know that that person is going to be sub what Jesus would have me think about the poor. So in my neighborhood, I'm going to have to live in that direction. Or if a Christian chose this side of it, we're going to have to live in this other direction. What would that mean? It means that, as we said last week, as a follower of Jesus, if I'm a Republican, my talking points ought to be different from non-Christian Republicans. And if I'm a Christian who's a Democrat, my talking points ought to be different from non-Christian Democrats. And that means that while we voted for this in the party that we chose as a follower of Jesus, we also are opposing and inviting other things in that same party, and the same over here. One way to say it is that our two parties, at their best, give us a short sleeve shirt for a winter day. The short sleeve shirt is great to have. It's a piece of clothing. It goes a long way, but it doesn't go near far enough. It doesn't have all the resources it needs to handle the breadth, the width, the height, the depth of the biblical story with Jesus as our King. Another way to say it is both parties at their best unwittingly reduce Jesus. And Jesus is the one through whom all things were created. He's the one that holds everything together. The breadth of what he says is holy and good and right is too substantial for our little human parties to handle. So I'm just assuming everyone's trying to do their best in this analogy and saying, at their best, this side of heaven, that is tough to figure out, and our folks need help. Well, what about this? Something else, two other things people will hear said, and then I'll close. What about someone who says, I'm sinning unless I vote for this party or that one? And that's certainly true. True, people are hearing that said. A prominent Bible-believing teacher who I probably agree with on so many things and I trust will be in the new kingdom together, but that person's come out and said any real Christian will vote Republican. You cannot call yourself a Christian and vote Democrat because of the Democrat stance on abortion, biblical marriage, and sexuality. And then a progressive, politician has come out who identifies as a Christian and says, Christian faith will necessarily point you in a progressive direction. When I think about where most of Scripture points me, it is toward defending the poor, the immigrant, the stranger, the prisoner, the outcast, and those who are left behind by what society said. But you and I just reminded ourselves, if we go to the teaching of Jesus, the breadth of Scripture, we can't separate all those out like that. And so if someone says you can't vote, if you vote for one party or another, you are sinning before God. I would want to respectfully disagree and invite you to consider this. First of all, it seems like that's biblically going beyond Scripture. I'm not aware of a command that we have to vote, nor a command to vote in a particular way or a particular time. So I'd want to take great care, feel, you know, within our commitments, not to bind the conscience with something God's word hasn't clearly bound us to. We may talk about it as a matter of prudence, a matter of opportunity, but to tell some follower of Jesus they are sinning on the basis of whether they voted this way or that way feels like that goes too far to me. Historically, we remind ourselves our Lord and the earliest Christians didn't vote, and they didn't have access to that kind of power, and they turned the world upside down. And the reason for that was Christians know that political power isn't the only kid on the block. It's not the only kind of valid power available. It's not even necessarily the most powerful kind of power in the end. And then culturally, I think when we go that far and say we're sinning there, we probably don't mean it. I imagine these folks do not mean this. So I wouldn't want to put words in their mouth. I'll just say, here's what I'm concerned about pastorally. I wouldn't want someone thinking that they're justified on the basis of their vote. I'd want them to know that this is not an easy thing. They're voting the best they can. We all make mistakes. We are justified by the righteousness of Jesus Christ alone. And how to try to help a conscience think through that would be our concern. Finally, are you saying then that Jesus is apolitical? And certainly there is a wonderful stream of Christian thought historically and currently that would say, yes, Jesus is apolitical. He didn't get involved in politics. And I want to honor those fellow brothers and sisters in Christ. I want to keep reading them. I want to keep learning from them. But I differ here, and I'll just say, you know, I'll throw it out there and see what you make of it. It seems to me when the Lord Jesus stood up in the Roman world with Roman soldiers watching him because of the size of the crowd that was coming, and when he spoke of a king, and he wasn't talking about Caesar, and he spoke of a kingdom, and he wasn't talking about Rome, it seems to me our Lord Jesus was anything but apolitical. He was making a bold, audacious claim that a different king and a different kingdom deserves our allegiance. And the leaders of the Jewish political leaders, the Herodians, etc., the Roman political leaders, they understood that. And as we saw last week. And so maybe, again, we can find language. It's something like, I don't think we could say the Lord Jesus was apolitical. He was profoundly political, just in a really different way than we're accustomed to. And learning what that way is what we want to help those we serve learn to follow. So I'm going to pause there and say a prayer, and then I look forward to the Q&A. Lord, here we are speaking about really difficult things. I'm reminded that we're children, fully grown adults, but yet children of yours. Children talking about mysteries and things that are larger than we are. We thank you that you know everything we don't. And we ask that you'd help us to find clarity together so that as fellow elders and leaders, we could be of good help to your people. We ask this in your name. Amen.
Amen. Zach, that was awesome, man. Really appreciate what you shared. And, you know, I'm trying to take notes and page after page. I'm just so grateful for just the amount of heart and work that you've done that hopefully translates to many of our people and communities being shaped in the direction of being closer to Jesus. I just want to start with the question that goes back to this idea of Jesus not only as a prophet, priest, and king, but the voice of a sage. Mm-hmm. There are several questions that kind of like came up from this, but when you think about our current cultural context, so, you know, the Western Hemisphere, the United States specifically speaking, and the general ways in which we communicate with one another, whether it's been the within a household, within our workplaces, and certainly our places of worship. To me, it feels like the sage voice and posture of communication is very rarely seen. And so I'm just wondering, from your point of view, are there places within our culture, whether it's within the context of faith communities or not, where there is a pretty clear representation of this sage-like voice and approach in just our day-to-day communication? Or is it something that truly for us as Western Americans that is so unique and even foreign to us? What do you think?
That's such a good question, and there's a lot to say there. But I think briefly, one thing that can help us is there are some historians and scholars who have said that the Western world, for the last several decades, has been deficient in wisdom. And so that's an interesting descriptor. I know anecdotally, growing up, I didn't have anyone in my life, family, neighborhood, culture, even my best church experiences, I didn't have anyone saying, get wisdom, though it cost all you have. It's better than gold. It's better than silver. You know, it's better. So a lot of us have just had that deficit in our life. And then the majority of us we're more familiar with Paul wonderfully and the Gospels and Isaiah and the Psalms than we are Ecclesiastes feels foreign to us. Job feels foreign. The Proverbs, we kind of get there. You know what I mean? So for a number of us, we've been doing our Christian life with a huge wisdom deficit, without realizing it. And there's a great deal of hope for that. But I think the first place you begin to see imitations of wisdom in structure, it doesn't mean that the content is wise, but imitation of structure is in artistry. So poets and those who write proverbs and fables and this kind of trying to get at a truth, they're coming toward a truth. They're not bypassing it, but they're coming at it slowly, softly. It's like our Lord Jesus. Well, who then is my neighbor? Well, our Lord could have said, well, let me tell you the Aramaic word for neighbor, the Hebrew word for neighbor. Let me give you five implications of how this is used, and then three encouragements as you go along your way. That's what I would do. But our Lord says, once upon a time. we all remember that once upon a time isn't weak. This is a soft answer that's about to break a bone, because at the end of that story, he's going to say, and which one proved to be the neighbor? And you know, for that Jewish man in that crowd, everybody's watching, his friends, co-workers, everything else. And he has to say Samaritan on his lips. It is a bold way of communicating, but it bypasses a lot of defenses. So our best storytellers, poets, that's one place. Another place are our counselors, our best counselors, who are learning, as the Proverbs say, to be a person of understanding, that draw out the purposes of our deep water heart. A lot of times that's quick to listen, slow to speak, slow to vent, locating the mood isn't just what is true and what to do. I hope that's there, but it's not just that. It's also, tell me more. What was this like? And gathering information so they can speak into it. And so those are two vocations that come to my mind right away that have these kinds of tools built into them. Again, it doesn't necessarily mean the content is wise, but the tool structure is there that the wise use.
Yeah, that's great. And even as you're sharing, I feel like there are two areas of learning that present themselves as opportunities. One is certainly the way that we're communicating and leaning into this sage approach, but then learning how to do that when it comes to these issues of politics. And so I think, I'm thinking about myself and I'm like, wow, Lord, there's a lot that I want you to help me reevaluate. Yeah, kind of like a new food that people haven't really been exposed to. It may at first seem so like, oh, what is this? Like, why is our people and our leaders communicating like this? But then the effect, the potential effect, I think is just really great. So I just appreciate that. Before I
Well, I
pass it off to
appreciate
Annie,
that.
before I pass it off to Annie, I want to remind our participants that at this point, you are encouraged to share your questions for this Q&A portion. So you can utilize the Q&A button and function in your Zoom window. And that way, we can continue to address as many of these as possible. So with that reminder out of the way, Annie.
Thank you, Dan. And Zach, yes, thank you so much for sharing this really good, meaty teaching with us. There's a lot to chew on. As you were talking about wisdom and communication, I was thinking about the variety of modes of communication that are available to us now as pastors and leaders that were not available to Jesus and the apostles. They were limited in some ways, in the ways that they were able to get their message out. But we have this multiplicity of modes now in which we can communicate with our people. And so just wondering what your thoughts are, for a local church pastor or an elder who sees a need to address some of these challenges within the congregation. Maybe they hear a prominent leader in their congregation make a political partisan statement that's very unchrist-like in a public forum or in an online forum. And how would you guide them in discerning how to best address those sorts of situations with wisdom, thinking about, options of email and, in person and phone call and when to do it in public and when to do it in private. I think those are some of the things that we struggle with now with all the options available to us.
We sure do. It's not easy, is it? And yet there's opportunity. And so I think, as I understand the scriptures, our first move is always re a relational one, and as in person as possible with someone. So if someone spoke in our community, and they said something, I would try to judge in that moment, does the group see this? Would this group push back on what this person said, or no? If I felt like the majority of the group, the Bible study or whatever, they kind of get this, they know this is this dear brother and this is how he speaks, then I won't feel the need in that moment to correct publicly, but I'll go to him or her first privately, and try to talk that way. And if it was the other way around, then as gently as possible, but clearly, want to say I would want to address that. And I would want to commend whatever I could about our dear brother or sister who said what they said, not out of triteness or a strategy, but biblically, I'm called to do that. I don't want to say woe to you to anything that's praiseworthy, noble, commendable, in a brother or sister's life. So, I'd want to say that and then say, and yet, one of the things we're trying to learn as a church is this way of Jesus, looking at it this way. This, I think similarly online, if it's someone in our congregation, then again, I would want to meet personally. If it's someone at a distance, then I would want to choose the direct message first. And if I'm not sure if I can fully trust the person, I'll be very, well, I would say this, in a direct message, I wouldn't want to write a lot. I would be pretty brief. Thanks for what you're saying. There are two or three things that have really have me thinking, and one thing that's I'm realizing is bugging me. I wonder if we could talk more about it, because I think getting into an online debate, if we could talk on the phone or something like that, part of that is just relational care and integrity, but in this day and age, part of it is also innocent as a dove, clever as a snake. I don't want someone to just cut, copy, and paste what I wrote in a private direct message, and then they post it, you know, online. I think if I'm in that position where someone's going to post something, I just want to have addressed it publicly. And I know that's what I'm doing, and I know it's going to be posted in community with those who know me well, and I know we're going to take the risk and try. Yeah. But it would be interesting to think about what it would be like to tweet or post an Instagram post or a Facebook post with the five mood range rather than just two. Be interesting how different those posts might be. Yeah.
When you started sharing about these specific questions that could come up, right? Trying to respond to specific questions, like how can you vote for such and such party if you're a believer, if you're a Christian? And part of the challenge, excuse me, is trying to live within this created tension of the reductionistic approach of party politics, right? Yeah. Part of me is wondering, like, in what ways we're able to help people become aware of that dynamic, like as if it were a blind spot. I mean, we all have blind spots of a whole different, you know, different varieties. But that seems like something that I would love to ask people, like, do you recognize that the way that we're approaching this conversation has already staged us to be this or that when it is far more complex? So I don't know if you found a way to help kind of like set baseline foundations. So yes, okay, we're going to have some conversations about, you know, politics and all this kind of stuff, but can we agree that already we're putting ourselves in this framework where we're often reduced to choosing this or that, and then maybe bringing in, you know, this idea that who Jesus is and how he lives and calls us to live is so much beyond that. Like, I don't know if you found it helpful just to kind of like set those kind of baseline foundations, or to kind of take a very, you know, indirect approach. So I don't know if you have any thoughts of that.
Well, that's a great question. And there's a reason that I did that in this second webinar. The risk is that this is someone's first webinar, right? They didn't see the last one, so they're coming in here. When I say risk, what I mean is where we began was let's look at Jesus. So someone who cares about the scriptures and loves Jesus, it's like I'm a fellow traveler and we're just looking together. Did you notice that? Did you see that? Wow, what do we make of that? I mean, isn't that, I mean, it seems like he's saying this, doesn't it? You know, and we're reminding ourselves of our biblical story, the story that we're part of, the true story of all things. If someone is aware, being reminded of that larger, truer story and who Jesus is, it is much easier. They have more tools when we say something like, how could a Christian vote Democrat or Republican? If we, in my experience, if we just, and that could be local, this is just anecdotal experience, although I've spoken about this in very different parts of the country in different settings, the common experience is that it is that question in particular, how could a Christian vote a certain way, particularly in the theological tradition and environments I'm part of, right behind that question is, what do you believe about abortion? And because those things are situated so closely, people are on alert if we haven't started in another place with the Lord Jesus. So if I'm in a conversation with someone and I have a sense that they care about our Lord Jesus and the Bible, I'll just quote Matthew 15. I'll just go right there and I'll say, remember when our Lord, he tells us about the things that defile us, And there are several examples that could be used in there. We chose the one about murder, but there's also sexuality. There's also lying and division, you know, and to go there and to say, in my experience, I've seen Republicans emphasize this side and Democrats emphasize this side. Have you seen that? And it's more like this, but we're now having a conversation and the text is in front of us. If someone has I feel like they have a fuller breadth of the scripture, I'll go to the Proverbs 6 too. There's plenty of more passages to go to, but those are two sort of summarizing, orienting places to try to say, can you see we're put in this position? And it's not so easy for people. And implied in that is trying to give Christians the benefit of the doubt. I'm trying to give most Christians the benefit of the doubt that they really want the Lord and they really want the scripture. They're really trying to do the true thing and they're having a hard time of it. I know that's not always the case, but just trying to have that posture.
A lot of what you shared even brings me back to how you started the previous first webinar with, you know, that account where you're speaking with other church leaders and your response to what was a very intense question was, hey, would you, something along the lines of, would you be willing to talk about Jesus with me? And yeah. So, you know, kind of as you're sharing in my head, I'm like, oh, baseline foundation, can we agree, at least in this context of conversation with believers, yeah. can we start with talking about Jesus and let Jesus be that baseline foundation? Really appreciate that. Thank you. Annie?
Thank you. Yeah, Zach, we had a question come in that I think will give us a good opportunity to talk again about Sage Christianity and some of the opportunities there with that ministry. Someone asked, what resources are available to pastors and church leaders to learn this way of wisdom and help believers embrace it?
That is a great question. And I guess I would start there with Sage Christianity. It's a ministry that we've started here in context of our church, my wife Jessica and I, in the context of our church, trying to help in this way. So we have cohorts, we have conversations, and we have resources that we're developing. But secondly, a good thing that's happening is for a long while, churches that don't see the Bible as God's word, that don't see the virgin birth or the bodily resurrection of Jesus. For a long while, those churches, that tradition was writing books about Jesus as our wisdom. And they were writing it from the vantage point of the kind of approach to scripture I was just mentioning. Thankfully, in the last 5-6 years, there are a handful of good books coming out from Bible-believing, evangelical, reformed people who are looking at wisdom, not necessarily the way we are, but they're helping us get a sense of what wisdom is. That's a real help. And this is also happening in our other than Christian scholarship. Sociologists, psychologists have a renewed interest in wisdom. Now, they're not looking at biblical wisdom, but you and I know wherever they find true contact with things that are wise, we know where everything good and true comes from. You know, there are things they're saying that can be off in some places, but they resonate with the scripture in other places. And an interesting implication about that is that if you read a Christian talk about emotional intelligence, this word, sometimes we might not agree with, you know, everything that's being said there, but at its best, you could insert wisdom sometimes, because what they're reflecting on is quick to listen, slow to speak, slow to anger. How do we recognize, like Paul said, always gracious, seasoned with salt, being able to answer the one who's in front of us, you know. And so there are some resources coming out like that. And you know what? Some universities now are starting to have, as part of their freshman orientation, a class on how to talk to people you disagree with. Now, that's not the breadth of wisdom that we're talking about now, but it's a little, it's a little thing that I never had anybody talk to me about. And so, I don't know everything they're saying, but the idea of it sure sounds like a wise thing. Yeah.
That's great. A phrase towards the end of, what you were sharing came up where, and some of us may have heard this before, but all of us are worshiping someone or something.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes it's God that we worship, but we're always created as beings created to worship, we're always worshiping, right? And so
yeah.
I think the reason why that surfaced in my heart tonight was, when we think about these questions or even these approaches and assumptions towards people of different viewpoints and different political affiliations, it almost feels like there is that issue of allegiance that almost prevents us or creates a very challenging obstacle to having a softer or open posture. In other words, and this might be really extreme, but even the Pledge of Allegiance, right? But that word allegiance.
Mm-hmm.
And so if we,
yes.
in this context of elections and voting for different leaders, it's like if we're voting for someone, the mere act of voting somehow in our hearts and minds, frame it out to be like, now I am 100% devoting myself. And any sense of dialing back or even saying, oh, the other party has some worthy viewpoints, like that is not allowed, because in so doing that I am betraying the one to whom I am saying yes to. You know what I mean? And
yes.
so I don't know if you feel like that's either in a very explicit, pervasive thing, or it's more of a subtle thing. And I don't know what the alternative would be, whether to hang on the framework of allegiance and say, our allegiance is with Jesus, or take
yes.
a different approach and just say, like, can we step back and say that when we're engaging in these things, it's not so much that we are 100% giving ourselves to such and such party or candidate. So anyway, I didn't know if you had any thoughts about how that thought of devotion and allegiance could either hinder or allow us more space to change and to acknowledge the other party.
Yeah, that's like the first, it's that which lenses are we looking at things through? Are we looking at our country through the lens of the better country that we're part of, the better kingdom, or are we looking at the better kingdom through the lens of our country and how subtly that shifts for us? And then something that comes into play there is fear. We're afraid for a particular way of life or for children or grandchildren, nieces and nephews. And we don't want to see the bad things or hard things happen to them. So that can be a big motivator sometimes. And we don't realize what the fear is doing to us. But that's very real for us. And there's a reason that Jesus was called a Samaritan. Part of the language that some of the Pharisees used to denigrate Jesus was they called him a Samaritan. And he did seem like a sellout to some of them. Why wasn't he saying that his nation and his people were prioritized and more clean than others? And so when we talk like this, it can sound, if unless we have a robust view of patriotism and how it is different from nationalism biblically, then it can sound like we don't care about our own people. And this is not unique in the world, but it is a particular challenge that we have. At least my interaction with Christians from other parts of the world, they ask questions of surprise. What's happening to us? What's happening to America? What's happening to Christians? Many other parts of the world Christians are tempted to different idolatries. One of the things in our country, if missionaries were coming to us, is that we have such a rich heritage of the Bible in our country. It's one of the, historians would point out the difference between the American Revolution and the French Revolution, and who wants a revolution but would give thanks, you know, would historians who aren't Christians would point out the merits, the materials that were involved that allowed folks who weren't necessarily Christians who were in charge, but who nonetheless were borrowing from Christianity, and that shaped things differently than the French Revolution. I think to be able to commend things like that and at the same time know that we also have made a lot of terrible mistakes, and to be able to do both is a good sign when we're no longer able to commend, defend, and invite everyone the way the gospel would. That's one of those check engine lights, and it just so easily slips in. We need a lot of help.
Amen. Yes, we do. Well, Zach, this may be our last question for the night. You started to address this a bit when you were talking about the fear that can sometimes underlie some of our political anxiety, I'll call it. I think oftentimes when we start to go off in a direction that is pulling us away from Christ or pulling us away from the way of the cross, it's often a genuine, legitimate spiritual need that we're trying to address in a counterfeit way. And so I wondered if you could talk a little bit about, you know, what are some of the genuine spiritual needs that our people have that they are trying to address in a counterfeit way when they're drawn into, you know, just this rabid partisanship that we see so often in the church.
Yeah, that's such an important question. Maybe for this moment, we'll stay with fear. When we're in a moment of, if anyone's old enough, I'm 55. I can remember times when we had a politics of vision rather than a politics of fear. A politics of vision is still messy. Everybody's at odds with each other. It's the fallen world. We're not in heaven yet. But a politics of vision is something like this. My opponent and I both care about this, but I think the way he or she's going about it is mistaken. I think the way we want to go about it is better. And I want to tell you why. It's a politics of vision. You encountered it with, I'll give two examples. One with John McCain and President Obama. You can find this on YouTube. There's a clip there where someone disparages President Obama in front of John McCain, and John McCain is in a stump speech. He's campaigning or whatever, but he stops and he says, "No man, no man. He and his family are decent human beings." You know, he put a stop to that kind of talk. Another example on the flip side was George Bush the younger and John Kerry. Again, you can find as if they were debating, and some of the Democratic supporters had drawn George Bush's kids into it. I think it was a daughter or something, drawn them into it. And at the debate, John Kerry says publicly to his supporters, "We will not do that. This is a decent man. I've met his family." You know, that kind of picture is a politics of vision is still holding on. There's something staying there. This is about our country and the way it can flourish. A politics of fear, when we dip down into that, is more populist oriented. It is the Romans are going to take your family, your way of life, your history. They're going to steal everything you've ever known. They're all evil. And unless you vote for us, you're doomed. At that point, there's no vision. It's just fear. And whenever politicians enter that kind of thing, it works. They do it because it works. And so as I find, as teaching and ruling elders, as local caregivers and ministry leaders, helping people locate their fear, What is it they're afraid of? And then now we're teaching, what does Jesus teach us about fear? How does he enter that fear? What does he do with it? Where do we turn with it? And to remind ourselves that, as we just hinted at again, Jesus, our Lord, doesn't stand up and say, be afraid. Be afraid, everything. He doesn't, that's not him. That's not his voice. When that's happening, that's somebody else's voice. That's not our Lord's voice. And there's a great deal of comfort and courage and love that casts out that kind of fear. And that can set us right side up again. We'll still have to figure out how to vote in this reduced challenge that we have and all of that stuff. But we can come to our senses again, if you will, and not just react out of our fear, but say, oh, okay, we have resources from the gospel to handle our fear. And we can do that together with the ministry of God's Spirit through Jesus Christ. And we probably need help thinking about fear in that way. Our people probably need that more than we know.
Amen. Well said. Dan, I think you had one more question before we wrap up for tonight.
Yeah, and it's funny that Zach, you brought the word vision a few times, because that was linked to a question I had for you. In conclusion, given that this is going to be hard work, right? Like, this is really complex, even sensitive stuff. But for you in the work that you're doing, your ministry, Sage Christianity, all of the above, like, could you paint us a picture of what you feel like the potential fruit or the outcome is if we as God's people learn to do this well, if we really engage Jesus in these places, if we did the hard work, what kind of fruit or benefit do you think would be the result or the outcome?
That's such a good question. I think quickly, a negative and then an incredible positive. The negative would be that some people realize that Jesus as the Bible presents him, isn't who they want. So if we bring clarity to Jesus as the Bible presents him, in contrast to other worldviews co-opting Jesus, some folks will say, well, I prefer the worldview, than to Jesus. But the profound upside is that the people who know and love the Lord Jesus, the people who are part of his flock, they are set free, and they see him more clearly. It's as if they say, ah, there he is again, and they love him and they want to follow him. And they were being attacked. They were being disinformed, whatever, spiritually speaking. And they see the Lord again. And when the people the Lord has brought to himself, when they see him clearly, they want him, and then they're strong in all the gentle ways, all the wisdom from above ways. We become open to reason again. We become impartial again, sincere, gentle, peaceable again. And, if you've ever encountered someone who is contented, like solidly contented in the midst of all this stuff, we don't tend to look at a person like that and say they're weak. We tend to look at them and say, what is that? what kind of strength is that? And I think that is, not only will the Lord's people feel that strength again, but we'll be salt and light again because of it. And the Lord will be glorified. There will be good done for our cities until he comes.
May it be so.
Amen.
That's a beautiful vision. Well, Zach, I want to remind everybody again, you are the pastor of Riverside Church in St. Louis. Folks, if you would like to reach out to Zach or get some more information on the ministry of Sage Christianity, you can visit sagechristianity.com or .org. And I'm sure you'll find lots there to inform your ministry and direct you as you think about these things. Zach, thank you so much for spending this time with us over these two webinars. Really appreciate it.
Thanks a lot, Annie. Thanks so much, Dan. It's good
You're
to be
gift,
with
brother.
Everyone.
Absolutely.
Thank you, everyone.
And friends, stay tuned. We will be coming to you with more Kingdoms and Identities webinars. And so we hope to continue equipping you and supporting you as we march toward November and beyond. God bless.
Amen. God bless you guys.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.